Ambient Poetry Night. Thanks for coming, and thanks for bearing with us all. So first is Goodparley. I'll let the poets introduce themselves because they can tell you more about the things that they do. And a big thanks to Poppy for organising the Poetry Festival. Who's over there?
That was a piece of music by Eric Santi that I like, and then loads of things. And Poppy is going to come and talk now.
everyone. So I'm Poppy. I'm a poet and an artist from Leeds. I wasn't supposed to be performing tonight, so I just want to thank Millie for letting me take the spot really last minute. I am also going to kind of pause between poems, give Ollie some musical time, so if it looks like I've forgotten what I'm doing, it is intentional. Okay, so the first poem I'm going to read is called An Ode to the Mini Pill, and there is a line in it that sounds like it's mocking men's mental health, and it's kind of more of a critique on the kind of toxic discussions from the time. They've read the news and roll their eyes and sigh when they hear of the trial's demise. It's not worth the risk when they become ill. Come on, girl, and swallow that bitter pill. Published that morning, the article reads, male contraceptive works, but work it needs. Oh, the disappointment those women faced, learning that their burden won't be replaced. It isn't well known that the trial took place. No wonder it's so hushed in cyberspace. But there are a few kicking up fuss, minor side effects they want to discuss. Cramps in their muscles and acne breakouts, an increase in libido, and then she shouts, God forbid they want to bang more often, and some poor men must face their depression. It's not an alarm that wakes us most days, but the cramps in our gut, the aches and pains. I can feel the stomach acid churning, wrapped in my sheets, I try to stop squirming. And once the nausea begins to subside, I am reminded of the other downsides. Alarm still blaring, ringing in my ears. A migraine manifests, but I try to stop tears. There's some water on my bedside table. Pop out the pill and swallow when able. Chase with painkillers and a slice of toast, even though my appetite's worse than most. Time to strip down and jump in the shower and lose myself in the hot water's power. But under the heat, my breasts are quite sore, tender, and look, more stretch marks than before. Steam does nothing to settle my belly. Acid is rising, knees turn to jelly. Quick to the toilet, up comes my last meal. Gross, but I feel my better. But my stomach is better, I feel. Look in the mirror at my reflection. A cluster of spots ruins my complexion. They're angry and red, concealing my cheek, and each one makes my self-confidence weak. Even puberty did not serve me this many mood swings that I cannot dismiss. They're all highs and lows I must endure, getting through the day an emotional blur. Do you remember being taught to respect, to love all women, to cherish and protect? But each day you watch this labour proceed, watch pain and trauma without helping me. There are pros and cons of this mini pill. You see this struggle every day, but still can't help but see the upside of this task when I say not pregnant each time you ask. A bitter truth that underlies this test unsettles the gossips and causes unrest. The men were free, volunteers, and yet at the start, terms of choice were never set. Those shackles were not an option for most, who were forced to take a sterilizing dose. So the public could cheer freedom of choice, though Puerto Rico had lost its voice. Another setback, the burden remains. Women must tolerate the bonds and chains that were given to them in 1961, like a saving grace or a ray of sun. Between the blades, between the fingers, between the sisters, whose hands peck like ravens' beaks that pluck the spoils of fallen threads, to catch the souls that fall between the blades, between the fingers, between the hands of three sisters that measure the worth of we poor souls, whose lives exist in lengths of ribbon or thread or string, that catch on the broken nails of shaking fingers on reckless hands, a wrinkled wrist that roll with the crisscross of cat's cradle, to twine our trembling souls between the blades, between the knuckles, between the crooks of fingers on hands on wrists, entangled by the fragile souls that exist in strands of thread dyed red, by souls snipped between the blades, between hands of the careless crones, who control our hearts and lungs and minds like a game of Jacob's ladder, pulled tight too tight between the chipped nails of crooked fingers, of jerked hands and tangled wrists, holding the trembling blades, slipping blades, that nick the red thread of that one soul caught between the reckless hands between. Pretending to conference call and read his reports to his boss down in London, working from home, but it's really his mistress who lives down the road, an old friend of his wife who's got a nasty cough and a dryness in her throat she's been brushing off. even though she's been called into hospital and her voice is disappearing little by little, so she can hardly talk with her doctor at all, when she has a coughing fit and a sudden fall, and her dog is barking, scratching at the front door, for people to notice who don't write shopping lists anymore. This last poem is called Places We Belong. There are fishing boats on the beach, temples surrounded by palm trees, waves rolling in over mounds of golden sand, golden robes swaying in gusts of hot wind, cocoa beans, papaya, and sweet potatoes shipped to the caves of Lascaux, where hills flow in bursts of green and vines grow from the skulls and bones beneath the rumbling busy streets, and oil paints smudge clouds through icy gusts on the mountain peaks, to the ships moving across endless depths, storms raging and turning water into whirlwinds at the backs of Viking men, axes brandished, eyes seeking land on the horizon, the sun burning the sky shades of gold, and glittering in the trail of vessels fleeing the middle passage, bodies packed, chained, shackled, hotter than Montego Bay, where rum pours like waterfalls, spirits jive and music enchants the soul.
My name is Niv, I'm a spoken word poet. A lot of my poems are about my culture, my heritage, my identity, and a lot of exploration, me being a second generation immigrant from Sri Lanka, I'm Tamil. So yeah, I'm really happy to be here. A lot of the last year has been like a stunt in creativity, and now that the sun's out, I feel like I'm thriving again. So this first poem is called Summer Night. Sweaty summer nights, where skin presses against skin in a warm embrace, is where I feel most a woman. The gentle breeze enters through an open window and whispers my name. The dimming sunlight etches rays onto my naked thighs. The sweet scent of summer air calls out to me. Where have you been, my dear? We have been longing for your dancing feet on our soil. Sticky summer nights, where beads of sweat roll down each curve and crevice of my body, is where I feel most a woman. The melodic symphonies of my homeland ring out in my ears. My Venus sits collecting dust, strings left untouched throughout the cold months. Saraswati watches over, and ragas and thalas carry themselves through my thoughts. Where have you been, my Kanna? We have been waiting patiently for your touch of creation. Sensual summer nights. Where sweet nothings are exchanged between myself and the mirror is where I feel most a woman. My eyes trace the outlines of my temple. My hands make their way across smooth cocoa butter skin. My arms wrap tighter and tighter around torso, as if to never let me go. Lips part and the mirror asks, "Where have you been, my friend? Such time has passed since I've been in your presence." Sweet summer nights where everything is silent, but the song of crickets and birds nestling amongst the leaves is where I feel most a woman. I sit watching dusk approach and the pink and purple hues that cast themselves over me. My fingers entwine around each other and the bells around my ankles jangle with every movement on my feet. A fire within me has begun to burn furiously. The flame dances in the light of my eyes and her embers ignite a spark in my heart. Her hair reaches out to my mind and I'm engulfed by all her divinity and power. And although she rages inside me, I am at ease in her company. Her passion burns and I welcome her with open arms, like a friend or a lover who has been gone for far too long. Her flame dims whilst her eyes meet mine. She takes my hand and our lips touch. She gently caresses my soul and says, "I am here, my love. I know you have missed me, but I am deep within you, waiting for you to call me. Now stand up, speak out, sing loud, dance proud, prance about, jump high, jive till the morning is nigh, because you are a woman who knows herself, who cherishes herself, who loves herself and the world she has created." The next poem is from a series of poems I wrote last year called The Journey to Me. It was about 10 and each poem was about a different part of my life. So this one was the fifth one, I think, and it's just basically about second generation hybridity. It was hard to fit in growing up. English, Tamil, English, Tenglish, English, ish. It is easy to throw away the Tum out of Tumlish when people don't even know what Tamil is and when English is just English. I went to Tamil school and spoke English. I did my Tamil exam and wrote English and Tamil-ish. I went to English school and got asked to speak Tamil-ish. I come home and I hear Tamil and I reply, "Tumlish, Tanglish, Tenglish, English." So how could I fit in when I don't even know ish on the second generation shit? My mother once said to me, "You must pick one or other, Tamil or English." But where is the category for Tamlish, for Tanglish, for Tenglish, and all the issues in between? The next poem is a bit violent, so just a bit of a warning. It kind of stemmed from my parents. They give so much for us, travelling on their ones all those decades ago, to brand new towns, new cities, new countries, with brand new customs, traditions, cultures, and brand new faces, colours, people. They sacrificed so much for us, giving up their own dreams of creativity, of youth, of passion, all so that we can live a comfortable life. They endured the relentless taunting, the jibes, the jokes, the mockery, the mimicking, the racist graffiti, the black boots, the metal rods, the fists, the spit, the punches, the kicks to the nose, the knees to the gut that came with the colonial homeland, all to give us hope for a better life. So now when I see the same shit, different decade, what faith am I meant to have in this place that we call home? The thing is, we are still getting taunted. We are still getting mocked. We are still getting punched. We are still getting killed. Same shit, different decade. You say, "God save the Queen," but how can I stand up and sing with pride when the Queen don't give a fuck about us, but only the Commonwealth legacies of the sadistic British Empire? Same shit, different decade. My parents opened and closed a shop for years,
wearing smiles on their faces and nostalgic dreams of the homeland. Got called a packy here and there, but it became nothing to them. They put up with so much for us, but tell me to keep quiet, to keep my head down, to conform so as to not get into trouble. A part of me thinks I owe it to them, but when I stand up and sing, long live our noble queen, I am enraged. My blood boils and there's a fire behind my eyes. It ignites me to stand up, to speak out, to fight back, to march on for my children and my children's children and all the generations ahead who will look back and say, they gave so much for us.
Divided by discrimination, but we are united by otherness, by the darkness of our skin, by the blood we've shed. Our blood runs through this land under my feet, and it breaks me knowing I must leave you again. Running to hold you, I never want to leave your loving embrace. And it's in these moments that I wish I knew how to speak my mother tongue. But we don't need it because our touch, our eyes, our smiles, our laughter, closes these years of space between us. Is this love I feel? The beating of the Mirudangam in my heart, the chanting of the priests echoing in my ears, the scorching ground burning itself into me. My history beckons me. My roots yearn for me. Houses to schools, homes to rubble, memories to dust. Home is an unforgiving land, but there's no place I'd rather be. I'm in your arms and you in my heart. So light the lamps, beat the drums, ring the bells, for I've come home at last. I'll just get one out of the book. I've got one more poem. Mangoes are my favourite fruit, and I thought I'd end it on a poem about that, because it's mango season. So this is an ode to a mango. You are soft and supple. You are sticky and sweet like honey. You are the colour of the evening sun and turmeric paste. Your curves make me salivate, and the sight of your leaves and branches excite me. You mirror my youth, hot summer days in the homeland. You carry my parents' homes and their childhood memories. You represent my mother's touch of care and generosity when she presents you in perfect pieces in a bowl after dinner. My mother recalls past times of her climbing the tallest of trees just to sit at the tallest of branches, eating the sweetest of you. And when she utters those words, I dream of tasting Elam fruits and devouring you like Murugan and Krishna, even the gods prize you as a queen. You are an image of dreams. You are a mirage in the blistering heat. You are divinely feminine and sensual. I long for you all year round, and your wise summer months bring me such joy. You are a reminder of home, the way you come perfectly packaged, nestled together in a vibrant, gaudy treasure chest. You are a reminder of my mother and father's warmth, a reminder of their childhoods, a reminder of where I'm from, a reminder of my past histories. You are a perfect fruit. This season is fleeting, and I will once again spend months longing for your nectar. But I know I will hold you once again and have all these emotions flooding back the moment I set my eyes on you. Thank you very much.
Got one more poet left, wherever Kay is. I haven't met these people, so this is all new. Yeah, that was great, wherever you've gone. I haven't even said hello.
Yeah, it's weird. It's nice to be able to do this again, isn't it?
Hi everyone, I'm Kay, I'm an artist from West Yorkshire and I currently have my studio space in Leeds as well. I'm very nervous, I've never actually spoken my poetry before and poetry just as a medium is quite new to me. I've not really been doing it that long and yeah, I'm still kind of exploring it, but I hope you like them anyway, so yeah. The first poem is called Plucking Tomatoes. Tomatoes stem from a grotto the size of a nail, gifting a microscopic space for a shoot to grow. A green full of stumps and forgotten thoughts eradicating below, lay resting. From the nooks you can see, come, come, the seeds, show them to me. Pluck one, the plumpest of all, and feel it in the spheres of a finger, blushing in its free parts. Let's slide into the bark of the alder tree over there, attach a hinge in the splinter wood, and interlock them, our fingers, whilst we wait for warmer suns. I sank a fly in PVA today. An old hag tied a poison choker to my neck, both in search of the fruit, the core, to an apple and a mound. A mound that grew this tree, that blue bottles adorn and host, congregations, coronations, you can hear it. Roaring static, airwaves, handing out chalices from the old hag's cupboard onto the lips of abandonment. A sister dances in hot coal shoes at the never-ending side of the nook, where not even the flies will go, as the scents are too strong, and disrupt their dictator, in their calm abodes decorated in tinsel and charms and a toenail or two. They're obsessed with these cores, but there is none to spare. As every fruit I attempt, I choke, as the choker left a steaming bruise. I manage one seed, and maybe one tree can push through the acidity building in me. It'll wrap my thumb in my hair, and maybe then it will grow. Tires would pencil every bit of the way my body comes to get under its trail. A newer type of tattoo, smudgy and heavy like a wedding veil, it will cover me. Headphones and all past futures, future thoughts, would tangle in its engine's pipes. A moment of silence never once heard. And I wonder if I'd cry before the sockets loosened my eyes. Would the sooty clouds cover my face and my neck, my pelvis break? Or if I'd get a chance to see the lonesome crowbird fly and leave? A lot of my poems kind of have like a mystical element to them, and I think something about being queer and growing up with fairy tales, the two are often interconnect quite a lot, and I found a lot of conversations I've had with people, they feel the same. So like ever since I was younger I was obsessed with mermaids, and I still am. So this poem is called Mermaid. Stretchy cream, slavering, turbulent surfaces. holding ivory spikes and runny waters, rusty nails from the garden watering can with the flower picked last, with a scattered complexion sloshing around mossy concrete. He, it betrays me. How dare it? From birth, let me know of how it despised me so, as did every mouth from every observing gull that pecked and screamed and rallied in agreement. How scales of a fin much better suited the scales of a miserable shrub, whose spotty surfaces and disproportionate levels only encouraged it to mutter, nudge, maw, and maw. Leave it be, if only it was the bargaining type, and could see the siren swaying for its exhausted lout, and grant permission to counteract what a flurry of cells could not. To never feel claimed is the hand it gives, and so the recipient receives the lashings it takes, slips and slices of a deformed persona for daily engagements.
Thank you.
Thanks to all the poets, that was really fun.
We're going to take a 10-minute break so that the next person can set up and then get on with more beautiful words. Goodparley, who played the set earlier, is also selling some CDs, so flag him down if you want one. Next up is TV feedback. We've got three more poets doing their thing, and then it's going to be an open mic soundtracked by Ishii. So get your poems ready.
Thank you. pleasure to be here. I think this is the first Leeds Poetry Festival, at least that I'm aware of, that more people are coming to. And it's really special to see so many people here, especially given the circumstances that we're finding ourselves in. And thanks to Millie for inviting me. So I, in January this year, got a pamphlet published for the first time called For Mary, Marie, Maria, After the Nectar, Pyre and Linden Tree. And it's available through a really amazing independent publisher called Broken Sleep Books, who are based in London. And yeah, I've brought some copies with me this evening, a shameless plug. And you're more than welcome to find me, and I've brought some signed ones, so yeah. Okay, I'll read a few from this and then a few new ones. O.M. to launder love. Mary, at four today, I carried more than the weight of my backpack. And the lady told me it was okay, but not what she expected. Not what I expected. As I ate breakfast, 8 miles, ate the last slot from the same day appointments. Not what I expected. When the room ate my air, ate my words, when the test ate sensibility, when the lady ate my stomach with her bare hands and pressed. At four today, the holding, clinging, craving, intimacy, taking place inside, the trouble between us, the individual silence of each finger padding, deriding the end of this tender excess. At four today. I tried calling. I tried calling. Please hold. Hold. Basin cloud. Ribbon clouds lace deep pink over cranes outside, floating in the upper part of the window, small enough to hold in my palm. Ribbon clouds lace deep pink in the basin, bleeding sighs whispering across the tiles. I tried calling. I tried calling. I tried calling, so I wrote instead. Maria Goretti, in her loss, told me, Marie, mother, for to give, forgive. We were sleeping. Sleeping naked sleep, tucked up words in cotton envelopes, always took a little duvet thief. This is the part when you would roll over to suffocate for the gaze. It's Friday morning, questioning, what is love? Settling. The space between chest and armpit, a change in folding, manuscript creased. Corners not quite matching. Hungover anxiety that you won't read what is being said. In smudged pen, eyeliner condensation on windows opening to rush hour. Slowness caressing a city, a room, as the people sprint on, and on, and on, and I'm sorry I was late, and you didn't get your weekend. And it's a mouthful of concrete, shoveling cement in to push out is heavy, grey mixing round and round, and it goes round. It goes, mouths full of concrete are hard to conceive if you have a clean spade, but tarnished spoons and pronged forks are all that's free. And I'm listening to Lana on repeat, man, boy, ache passing through in this building site. breeze blocks are lighter than me. Heavy with grey mixing round and round and it goes round, a feeling that you're part of the clay. Holding down house history, him and her, mouthful of concrete. Is a stone scraping when the door goes and your duvet is heavier than breeze block clay. Restlessness. Chair, sofa, bed. Inertia. It goes round and we move forward. Brushing hands as we walk to the station where I leave. Leaving no epilogue. Awareness of tender thumbs hurting, now holding our own digits. A delayed echo of the loud, the night before. Inertia. We move. I forward to the exiting train, passing chair, sofa, bed. We move, our mouths full of concrete. Thank you. Thank you for that. I'm going to read a few from this last year, different tone now. These ones I suppose were in response somewhat to the last year of isolation, of a time of fear, of hope, of uncertainty, of loving, working, wondering. But they're also kind of just everyday, daily observations. And they're actually going towards a new publication coming out next year. So keep your eyes peeled. We'd heard the news, and now I see. My psoriasis flares up every time conservatives speak. Pink to silver flecks are glittery in a club when I'm dancing carefree. But this week, they crust over my eyelashes silvery scales I have grown to know. Reptilian when stressed, I grow more serpentine. As our PM returns on screen late for the announcement, late in the PM, Prime Minister premenstrual pink matter stressing. Pink to silver flecks follow the curvature of my body, their suspension saturated, creating the blur when I lose myself inwards in another blur and I am thinking again about my face, my neck, my private parts to adult life. My psoriasis flares up every time conservatives speak. Looking at each scale, parts to adult me, furtively awash in aqueous lotion. Nice pink smelling cream wrapping my nice pink skin. Each follicle undergoing change. They flake, despite all of these atoms, these silvery scales I have grown to know. My psoriasis flares up every time conservatives speak, but at least these scales flake consistently. And my aqueous cream soothes, unlike our PM's party. My psoriasis flares up and has its own party, pink to silver confetti. And my aqueous cream soothes to gentle recovery, to a soft sigh on time for the evening news. This one is, this is for Leeds, for Yorkshire. Momentarily escape. We stand engulfed on the moors, watching rain falling like veils undisturbed, as though souls of the air are returning to the earth, heather, our home of the north. We continue, wrapped in water, and you say how we're inside a cloud now, how we're within each droplet, found where the water leaves its river heart, and we move. Merging with its rushing breath, souls returning to earth, to heather, to our home of the north. I'll do a few more. This is for Ella. Bonfires hold heat, hold promise, crackles echoing laughter of girls with cigarettes, each face lit up. Good company has that effect, a soft glow. Bonfires remind her of nestled heads in the curve between neck and shoulder, at a party after school, or with mum in bed, inhaling her sun-spotted skin, all on an Irish coastline, perfumed but still wearing a raincoat that smells of smoke, and air a little damp like socks on the line. Outside, a slight chill settles in, the way wood smoke rests in fibres and stays there, as you wander home together, arm in arm, two girls dreaming of islands and kindling. Trips to Morrison's, walking the roads licked with sunset reds to our compost collection point, the smells of earth and damp wood filling each nostril. Listening to the woozy bass of drums and shrill violins in a black MIDI song, I walk through a swarm of midges. Just my luck. Senses overwhelmed, I think, this feels very pandemonium. Pandemic, epidemic, epidermis, the top layer of my skin is singing. I feel tingly when I talk to unfamiliar people, and I thank post-punk, maybe art-pop bands for their conveyance of my whirring synapses. Entering public spheres again, I think, this is the new normal. Just before the football, I'm sorry that it didn't come home. Boys carry cold crates and fold down their long socks, heading for green swathes of parkland. Commuter trains bound for the centre sigh and softly squeak. Buses stop with a long, grinding groan, taken aback by the proximity of passengers in the shelter. A friend opens our back gate, the creaks of hinges telling how long it's been. An invitation comes with a forecast of sun. Sunny in Kirkstall, we think. Sunny in the UK. People, some hesitantly, are looking up. By the river I sit, with the year that has passed. Today, you could have taken hold of the light, let it slip through your fingers, and watch soft pale shadows sigh. Starting over, starting again. As a heron takes to the air, I sense a slow release. Thank you very much for listening.
Yeah, and TV feedback. really interesting name. Love it though. My name is Taiwo. I'm gonna stand a bit further back. My name is Taiwo, I'm a poet from Leeds. Yeah, that's all I've got to say at the moment. Shout out my people in the back there. And over here, over there, yeah. People of content. I'm gonna do a few poems as well. But in classic fashion, I've not decided which ones yet, so it'll be a bit of a improv. Okay. I'm not as nervous as I thought I'd be, considering it's my first time performing in front of an audience for 18 months. We'll find out. Green and black in abundance to spill with abandon. Full to the brim with that high life funk. Kissing a random, enjoying a sip or a sample, all prim and proper. Falling deeper and more faded than my trim. Dancing with a slip, a humbling sort of tumbling. I mumble nonsense and some sense of love or longing for belonging, cause it must be. It must be Nigeria in the 90s, the way I'm so back to black, like I only have one outfit. And you see me in it, plastered to all these back streets. You may know me as the Taiwo of Taiwos and their candies as well, the firstborn of the firstborns, the one who welcomed the youth wasted on excess of expenditure, infatuated by all essences. Asphyxiating and marvelling at how fucking godly Ogun is. Fuck it. Shrug blasphemy. Time has blown its horn. The tongue's rot might chaos the chart to the heart, and I'll play the part of the displeased and destroyed. The latest ploy in the history of. Shit. The latest ploy in the case study of the victor justice, so watch me. Observe the becoming of a boy more grown than swallowing fish oil whole. Nowadays, I'm too back to black to say shit's tough. Head gone, rum gone, money gone. But still, we move. Just like we've always done. So I'm gonna speak a few words that relate to that over the course of a few poems. I confronted Blair about the lost lives. He said, nothing to do with me, a mealy-mouthed reply. Buhari flies to Europe for healthcare. I think it was never strange to fly thousands of miles for life at the risk of passing too far away from home. Now that the Mediterranean overflows with blood, it seeps through the sewers and the Red Sea becomes just that, with enough left to turn the channel rose gold. There are no shrines for unwilling martyrs, no busts in their likeness in Trafalgar or Dudden Park. So I remain reminded of the curses persisting for centuries, pickled lies bottled and dripped on the leaves of my tree that remains trimmed of a darkness that was only ever pure. The sea of capitalism, the sea that accumulates, is the sea of a cancer corroding cells. It is a conservative sea that could not tell the difference between the sea of pandemic, corruption and supremacy. Classrooms conceal that this has persisted for centuries. The colonizer sea of the church, the canon, the chain, crippling indigenous communities, then collapsing the portcullis on the channel. And now catch it coolly plot a trajectory towards climate disaster and calamity. I know we don't cut into skin suddenly, but slowly let's seep what our ancestors built into the sea that washes us all away. I cannot comprehend, though, that hard sea of continuation, that sea that is difficult to attain, the only sea we need, the silent sea we lack. In 1994, below Ulumo Rock, Ògún State is the place where Ògún was made. I was birthed carnivorous and cantankerous, but the chaos soon called me cadaverous. I grew up wishing this was one of them easy ones, my life that is, by 21, knowing that ain't the case. Due to riches and love, or more specifically, lack thereof, or complications with the above. And the other sort, being the awkward foreign kid, they easily minstreled me, but you see, these bohemians, they pick and choose it. For them, simply living is a decision. Roaming through Romani pockets and hoods while gentrifying neighborhoods, but I don't write to be new wave or political, I write because I should. Cause I'm a black boy from the north facing the oxymoron of shaping a culture and being without it. From the east of Leeds and only a minute to the north, knowing any second it could all go south. We were raised next to supremacists, they threw fireworks into our streets when I was 13. My sister was cycling with sparks to her feet. My dad and uncle, two or four black men in a half mile, stared down a gang of violent white dudes, though most of them were police. My dad was taken into custody because he was too loud at noon trying to protect the youth. A single occasion in a decade of confrontation, so for safety I became a sofa baby. Cartoons and cereals became my only activities. Because I never wore streetwise like Bugs Bunny, but all that Weedabix meant I could at least outrun these Yosemites. We were faced with original pirates in the streets, so a fraction of fraternities as kids turned tumultuous by teens. Now got degrees, but some still about it, still on site on a night, and you can ask them why. And they'll tell you. They'll say, what is the next step, please? Yeah, I got a certificate, but what about it? Not enough to eat off. Saddled as far as the state could bother, but it doesn't bother me, cause I'm numbed in neurology looking for some sodomy. So I'll write a rhyme for the hell of it. Ògún flexes and swigs rum. A black lit poet spits ink, kisses Mrs. Liberty to show the tittering on the edge of justice and corrupt cities. Gleam tomorrow in glasses cleaned by ass kissing, banter making, lads live in a raised rich minority, so fuck your democracy. So I'm gonna do. Thank you. So I'm gonna do one more. This is from a piece called Mumble. If you haven't guessed already, you probably know what I write about, but it's kind of similar, that sort of migrant angst, so to speak. If that's not a real thing, then I've coined it today, so please remember. I don't believe in copyright, though, obviously. Man's a nutty capitalist and all that, don't take that. So this is part 2 and 3 of Mumble. So begins the bloody business of the day. Shit, fucked up. Alright, this is part 2 and 3 of Mumble. So ends the bloody business of the day. So begins the bloody business of the night. When the swollen stones that drift through history call and ask you to prefer eternity over bondage, will you answer, let your existence be drowned by bravery? When they sweep the trash and snow-gloved strays from the shop floor, we do not serve your kind, will you freeze alongside in solidarity? When they film your last moments and upload it, and defer a beauty onto your morbidity you never requested, will you haunt like the spectre of white supremacy? When they sort skin and tone into coloured houses and debate whether race matters or if it is only skin deep, would you take a knee at a runway offline and become an activist beyond active speak? When the blues unfold, can you follow its source and dare to topple this world that swallows souls? Will you surmount the nation, gang and creed? And are you tribal marking the cheeks of believers and pagans alike? A black Muslim out of touch with spirit, society, identity, can they punish you a day beyond your life? Are you dying for money, pride, self-worth or clout? All of these, God even, in spite of the memories and moments so heavy that might tame that constant raging wave. Are you living for family, love, pain, destiny, all of these, hell even, in spite of the memories and moments so heavy that might drag you to your destruction? When it is your turn and there is no yam or anyone left to speak for you, will I find you bewildered or expecting? You will find me feeling long-haired and freaky. I do not need to apply. I know what they asked for. Heavy, you will say, but it is meant to be heavy. You will find me dripping with sauce on the morning commute, unshaven, confident in my own iron shirt, full of art in your offices, bending at the steams but steeze from every orifice. You will find me throwing back the bananas and making devil noises, taunting to redness in the football fields and hospitals, streaking naked on their campuses and streets, banned from your favourite local. You will find me exploding, sweating rum in the wavy uniform of a fuck, begging for quick and dirty love, and my heart is as intoxicated as my vessel, an avatar of fabulous disaster all the while. You will find me with the lightning attraction of Shango, demigoddish flying unicorns and supersonic Django. You will find me with the diaspora grinning at dysphoria, euphoric in our auras, awesome and triumphant as we fall, beautiful through our destruction. You will find me ecstatic, but only temporarily, feigning wellness. You will find me laid on my mattress of inertia and lethargy, bloated, guts full of passion, but body heavy from the hangover and the weight of grief. You will find me fastened to my seats in the freefall called 20s, falling like shells, flashing a little and full of smoke as I burst, arriving with a glorious short-lived bang that is only memorable through the ensuing scandal. You will find me crushed but crushing, with a stumble and mumbling, offering to forgive myself. You will find me at the gates of fortune, seeking to uncover the mask and mist, wary of stepping willingly into limbo or purgatory, and my sisters at my side telling me, your joy is where you left it. Thank you. Shout out to you, feedback as well.
Pretty nervous, so I want to get a good vibes. Everyone, give a clap. Thank you for inviting me today to read Millie. Thank you for all the poets that I've read, the musicians. It's really nice to be in a room full of people again, and yeah, it's just really fun. So my name's Dany. I'm a poet and I'm a composer. I'm going to be reading some poems today. So, yeah, the last time I read out loud was probably about a year ago, and it was when I was living in Germany. And the first poem I'm going to read today is called Berlin, and it's about a trip that I took there shortly after lockdown, because I had to leave and I came back. And so yeah, it's called Berlin. Woo! Thanks. Berlin. Berlin, I'm back, better. Surviving the reckoning. Hungry again, like the savage of killed kin for a fortress. England is a slasher. You walk out the cinema in awe. Magnitude roars your plushed seats and overpriced popcorn to the core. You're in England on a screen. And I'm in Ostkreuz, walking on speakers, graffitied bodies, the accepted syllables. Everyone itching to fuck and fucking to itch. Prissy England, whose tremor is a dietary recommendation, a vitamin. Berlin rolls, laughing, boisterous, the ink of poems, of staves, of clefs. England's smug in its Sunday dress, flicks the bottle lid, sets it a boomerang. England loves her interludes, loves to lace the corset, climaxing on choking. Thank you. Cool, so don't know if you can tell, but I am queer. And this next poem is kind of, I guess, maybe something that queer people can relate to. It's called Mist Brooding Over and Around It, and the name and the kind of quote that comes before the poem are taken from the book The Scarlet Letter, this idea of kind of about secrecy and sex and all that sort of stuff. So, mist brooding over and around it. My old native town will fall upon me through the haze of memory. Henceforth it ceases to be a reality. I am the citizen of somewhere else. When Arthur and I meet eye to eye, this November night for a moment flies. Instead, outlines compete, sunburnt, cruel waves of heat submerge, reemerge, and your feet. Your feet are, yes, where the skin shred and blisters bled. Drunk, teetering along oblivion, sacrificing burnt pain for burning pleasure, discussing our dreams like two pebbles bathed in shared stream. Autumn in a body, your leaves wilt as they remember the guilt falling and falling, demanding peace. Iced over, four eyes do their best to repel. You've a girlfriend now, you need not know. We made that vow when I was allowed, and when you were heavier in life than this half form before me. We're testing out the script we birthed then, only us observe these faces choreographed in these wings where ignorance wins. I stray away, improvise momentarily, such is my way. As fog-bent branches teem for sun, suffering silent morning dew nourishes the daffodils of spring. The weightless refrain of summer tides your sported logos to familiar freckles in constellations of lost misted roofs. Light too adverse to open, shards through the hawthorn chew themselves in anxious contemplation where once serenity was latent. As morning lingered the scene of dawn, the siren of day alighted the lawn. His transgression from that night to this day, like his bent back sprawled as he beckoned me to stay. Thank you. Okay, cool. So, the next one I'm going to read is called Night Possesses Me Nude. Night Possesses Me Nude. If night could render me green, a waltz wed in nature unfound and unseen. If night could blasphemy red, a frolicking harbour too proud to be bled. If night could arrest me in blue, charge me for gargoyles and pacts upon use. Were night ambivalent black or dormitory grey, reason unspoken, a crowd left to waste. Surely it would, in every of these motions, eclipse fatal day. Day, you hourglass safe bank, you turbulent waste. Day, you treacherous sorrow, you supermarket display. Day, whose timbre of tombstone discounted, inert and impetuous schema, whose dogma of diva, whose cackle of travel and sliver of torn, combusted and lucid rimmed marketing tour. Day, who boulders my brightness and leaves me forlorn. Save the galley of my gentle light, for one evening alone to be strummed by the webbed and the fledged and the wretched sent to bed, words unsaid, losing head, freight of Luna, who grins, and soon I'll again be lulled by the dull swing, the hammock of night. Thank you. So yeah, I've got three more. I just graduated from uni, woo! And I did like a collection of poetry for it, so the next time I'm gonna read it from that collection. And basically kind of the theme of it is looking towards the future, both on a personal level, how I feel about, you know, just the process of getting older, and then also just kind of like more generally as we're advancing, what the future might entail. So the first one I'm gonna read from that is called Anxieties, and it's kind of like subtitle is an auto-generated conversation between myself, my bot, my counsellor bot, and my funeral planner bot. So, anxieties. Joy is fickle. It mutates with age. That joy that once sought a rhapsody of crimson prays for one night of utter tranquility. And you cannot prophesize tomorrow's wants, as tactile and amorphous as the horizon. So count life's worth by every degradation, every phantom, the stations inhaled and exhaled, thrown and delivered into. Like scavenging hounds salvaging buried sounds, like a resubmerging snapshot of some British town. Please, please pause on this, 2028. Keep man on hands and knees. Fiction as fiction. The railroad dreams as ingestible as sinking sand. And the rewards of counselling undergone without mortar as immaterial as the pleasure of song. Yeah, this is the final one of that kind of collection. And yeah, the collection's called 2028 Dead, which was the reference in that, and there's another reference in this to that year specifically. So this one's called A Sequel Becomes a Sequel of a Sequel Becomes. A sequel is 20 becomes 21 becomes 28. As talkative becomes tentative becomes therapy. Like a child will always choose the rotating door. Some of the adults prefer hydroelectric dams. As verses become, aversions become detergents. Like the four corners of a rounder's court and the 160 floors of the Burj Khalifa. And as spurts become flirts, become crisis. As flatlined yet jolting, yet jagged, as rabid, as crocodile tongues cracking under stage lighting, this is the scope, and it is a scout, and it is a savings account, and it is increasing, stasis, paving the way for inner, the ingrown uphurting, that I was, I, and I am I when I became, and I'm becoming a wreath, becoming, and I have become a battery. Thank you. So, one more. So that's kind of looking towards the future. This next one's actually about the year 2020. I'm sure we can all relate to having intense feelings about that year. So this one's called 20 ad infinitum. The desk and the bed have become one work, one home. The work and the home have become one bed. The desk and the head have become one. The pans and the plants have become their own together. The plans have become a plant on a bed, waiting for a man with a watering can. The year has become an anecdote. The desk and the pan are for scribbling down meal plans. The plants and the meals have become their own together, inseparable. The dents on the desk have become one scribbled anecdote. The phone and the hands, fertilizing a year's worth. Scribble and year, one together, inseparable word. This year, I've learned to become one fear, one with, one uncertain. I have learned the meaning of the year's end, and I have become one, starting with one again. Thank you. As I said earlier, thank you so much for having me. It's been a very inspiring night, and yeah, I'm really excited to kind of hear more people come up and read some stuff as well, so thank you.
Another 10-minute break so that the next person can set up, and then yeah, whoever wants to come up and read their own poems is more than welcome to. Please do, it'll be really nice. And if anyone's performed who has some more stuff that they want to say, feel free to come up and say that. Yeah, but after a 10-minute break.
are you?
Sorts of things like spilt milk, your mother not crying, saying don't cry, don't cry, don't cry, over and over again until her face is bottle top blue. All the million bits and pieces kept whole, saying it's only milk spilt. For you, the world could have been that thick layer of cream. You could have made it a scoop with your baby finger. What happens to porcelain skin when it stops being skin? How does it get whiter? Does it shatter? 1,000 shards like bone china hit the floor the way the stars hit the bowl of the sky. I'm in the habit of saying oops since I watched a damaged cabbage slip through the net. Butterfly wings faltering, like every oops, a cosmic accident, like each self can be traced, turned over, exposed, saved, slipped into my pocket, the upward belly of a shell. And then the irreversible hole, the losing, the quick rewinding, and the slow unravelling, frantic static, like are you here, are you there, where? And this one is a bit happier because it's about my sister, who's the cleverest and most hardworking person I know. But I've lost it right now. It's called My Little Sister. Your tiny nose delights me like a brand new coin. It is always your face, bright as a moon, full of hope and holding secrets as sisters must do. As you have aged, the years no longer contained on one hand of soft fingers, but shifting to two. Your brain has become a briefcase of scientific facts. Little woman, I am so proud that as you storm into the world, I get to say, I have known her my whole life, which is both cheesy and true. And I'm glad too for you and your brilliant news, the way it's illuminated this gusty and grey January day. You've made something of it as you always do. Whether you're laughing boldly at silly videos, making your special tiramisu, solving some mighty algebra question, or trying tequila for the first time, look at how you grow into all you do. Even when you bite the top of my arm, when you rip the skin and it begins to blister, when we'd argue in the middle aisle of Lidl and an old lady buying yogurt tells us off, you were, still, will always be a good luck charm, softer than the body of a bumblebee. I'm swelling with pride over and over like an October Norfolk tide. I'm the boomerang coming back, the cheerleader on stilts, the first Christmas card of the season, and a duck's last quack. You are the woman setting off for the moon for the very first time. I could never have guessed you'd be so sublime. When I heard you growing, felt for you becoming, through our mother's skin and some green jelly. Oh, brave and lovely Evie. Thanks.
From like a long ongoing, potentially endless project. It's inspired by the American poet Bruce Boone. He's released a book of 600 pages of poetry called Wallpaper, and he's mental right now is just kind of endless writing, and it's all very exciting. It's about like his life with his dom, and he's the sub, and they get up to all these wonderful adventures. Mine comes from lockdown, it's not nearly anything like that. Okay, yeah. Words may combine or they may not. Lines may combine or they may not. Yeah. Wallpaper, too. Our mother and some walls. Time for all of it. My floating definition of a bad poem. Getting pinned against a mushroom tree. Behind the station, the city, any river. Mnemonics give way to a democracy of anxiety. The only threat is your workplace. Dust remains a lack, inert in the atmosphere. The crushing orange of missing out. We take a bait and retreat, as couples do, to where the day ends, going to a forest and lose nature. Specifically, I've forgotten which arrangement of fabric produces writing, or a writer among these walls. I get the sense of an ode to a city swallowed up in light. The force carrier is irrelevant, apportioning a truant touch. A poem that takes place wholly from the perspective of bedding, as this angle swallows the world like, I can't get out. Eating in a dream is the reversal of nourishment, the losing dog. The local color fades, everything is packed away. The day by day shatters enjoyably, the regal in the riot, the choked sun. I forget it, night plums, sprigs of sex, and I'm listening to the atmosphere, void of flight, churn at the edges of the room. Somewhat the speculative production of houses, splintered along the gaze, between the private being, may confess. There's a didactic simplicity in burying a slogan in perception. At the moment you strain your eyes, you've set someone free. The reader hovered over the paper like a sainted stylight. The past bears me as a glottal slumber. There might be a dream of abstinence yet, a purse lump of flesh tailed us, a rat. I don't know what the cloud icon on my phone does anymore. I get the message. When the weather becomes a historical contingency, the sole fact of history, I pass time between the cup and the lip. A bigger twist of jello than what can be tasted. All that the satellite names, the many options of the river. When you hasten a syllable before another, language becomes its vernacular. Releasing a syllable after all others makes for a synaptic world of your own. It scares me to accept good fortune, the quenched heat of past summers, grafted and hungover, the overlay exceptions to the state, the many options of the river, all transitive, sudden affiliation to what this sound suffers through, salt on the regression, we've called it correspondence, the caustic blue of why bother it. A good coast is a proliferative etching, erased by morn in the sorority of grays. Will algae penetrate the rock in a tepid orange if you've seen it before? Okay. That's all. Thank you.
It's my first time reading my poetry, basically. But I really feel it's very important to share this with you. So just, my name is Daniela, by the way. This poetry is seen as a choreography. So it's composed of two parts. The first one is called like just first movement. And it's called, the poetry is called Empty Room. I'm standing in an empty room, empty as this word document, empty as my empty stomach. I'm sitting on a dusty sofa, dusty as the dust in my eyes, dusty as the dust under my nails. I'm thinking about nothing, nothing as nothing. I can swear there's music outside. Color, joy, passion, desire. There is no outside. all is lying in this vacuum brain who reflects so beautifully the world. I rarely think about memory. It is hard to remember when was the last time I remembered myself. I rarely think about biology. Bios means life, but there is no life outside. Instead, there is imagination, which is composed of I magic nation. I am sitting in this empty room. I am naked in front of a mirror. The mirror is naked in front of me. I am saying I want to dispossess of myself. I want to dispossess of my body, of this empty, small, empty room. I live in captured as a pressed flower in a blank book. I want to have a word about this, about all that impinges on the body and mental flow. I want not to want. I choose not to choose. Second movement. When I look around, I imagine life it is just an abstract concept. People get a glimpse of what life is, then they die. I look at my hand, I see my bones, I see my nails, I say, move. And the hand moves. My first thought, my hand obeys me, I control it, I am the master of my body. My mind is savage instead. It tells me to see the things people have in their hands. It tells me people have jobs, people have boyfriends, a house, children. It shows me their profiles in case I still have doubts. Look at their smiles, look at the photos they breathe in, the clothes they wear, the places they visit. My mind carries me through all these places, but it tells me you are not there. You are naked in your small empty room, that's all you have. I listen to these thoughts and I say, I'm the master of my soul, I have the control, I have the discipline, the power to delete all these intrusive thoughts. I'm not deluded by your marketing promises. I have the courage to stay here without fear and face you. I'm not this body, I'm not this mind, I'm not my job, I'm not the couple, my relationship, my past, my future, my imagination. Let me alone and naked in an empty room because I can have and I can be everything and nothing. History will find a way to drag me into its cosmic battles. Third movement. I'm standing on this empty page. No thoughts. It's another one, which is an experimental poetry. It means that I tried basically to write a poetry composed of three languages. I'm very sorry, it's composed not only by English, it's also French and a little bit of Romanian. So it would be just interesting to listen to it. Snow, snow, falling. We falling in snow, falling in low, 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 in love, 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 lost, lost, lost. In low, low, loneliness, we are alone, baby. We, nous sommes au bout du monde, au cul du sac. Partager la misère. La mimi demi-heure, à mimi midi, plus heureux qu'hier. Comme c'est amer la misère, la mer, mer, mereu să ne amintim de primul fulg, fulguire. Pe bocanci noroi și zăpadă, așa și you, 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 you. Iubirea, you, the only one I've ever loved. And I'll ever love. Do you know? Do you know? Do you know? well. Thank you very much.
Performed a poem since the first one I wrote in about year 8. And by the way, hi, I'm George, precursor. Despite the way I decided to dress today, I am not a girl. I feel like that's a nice thing to introduce myself with. They, them is perfect, thank you. I haven't written a poem in years, so this is very scary. I came up with the idea for this about half an hour ago, when I'm not good with names, the person wearing the awesome Plantasia t-shirt was performing, and this popped into my head, and I've been writing it in my friend's notebook. So we'll see how this goes. Place number one, 13 and 7, 7th Street. We had a devil on our door, an imp to be precise, a door knocker, a staple of our city. When the electricity got shut off, we would cover ourselves with blankets and pretend we lived in an igloo. We had a staircase full of naughty steps, and my parents' door had the letters R.I.P. mounted onto it. I never questioned that. I can't remember how old I was when I moved out. Place number two, my grandparents' maternal. They called it the Tall House. I barely understood why we were there. I truly accidentally clicked on an advert for divorce lawyers whilst watching YouTube. My mum saw and hugged me and cried and thanked me for being helpful, but said that I didn't have to. I was very confused. Place number three. A flat above some garages. Heat is supposed to rise, but there was no heat below us to be risen. My mum, me, my little sister. I hated year 7 and discovered love cats by The Cure. We had a balcony we ate on and a big glass bird murdering wall. It was the first place I watched Mamma Mia. It was the last place I remember hugging my mum. Place number four, a servant's quarters next to the old giant cathedral on top of an old giant hill. The neighbours downstairs were nice, but I was jealous of their tall ceilings and garden and nursery and snacks, so I lied so I wouldn't have to see them again. I learnt what tarot cards are, and I watched Blackadder, and I comforted my mum when she found out about my impending younger brother. Co-currently, place number five, my other grandparents followed granddad, because my dad couldn't afford his own place. Place number six, a lady in Kexby who owned a Great Dane. We slept on the sofa bed. I discovered Minecraft playthroughs and Little Shop of Horrors. My dad sat in the garden and whittled because he couldn't afford his own place. Place number seven, a cottage in Burton with a blue front door. He fed us Mars bars and microwave noodles and fed himself vodka and coke after vodka and coke, the old classic. I had my first period there, and my dad was so proud and honoured that it was his home I christened with my blood, like I could choose. I was uncomfortable and knew him well enough to know that we wouldn't be in the cottage for long. Place number eight, a cottage in the middle of the countryside with a black Labrador next door. A tree farm, me, my sister, my mum, her boyfriend and his two kids. Four of us to cramped bunk beds in a room, a box room separated by my mum's bedroom by a thin door. I don't remember much from that time or any time. Most of my life is hidden from me like a benevolent older cousin put their hands over my eyes and ears to block out the badness. I have to really concentrate if I want to remember, and I always regret remembering. I would sleep downstairs to avoid the noise my mum would make in the bedroom when I told her I could always hear. She laughed and said her poor boyfriend would be so embarrassed if he knew. I cried at night and covered my ears, and sometimes I still do. Place number 9 was the last place I lived with my mum and any of my family blood. It's where I discovered that I was George, and it's where I raised my younger brother for the first year of his life. If I had known that was the last time I was going to see him, I probably would have said goodbye before he went to sleep. I wasn't the first to leave, I was the third. I also wasn't the last. My mum's boyfriend's kids decided to leave the nest first because, like me, they were kind of sick of it. The next place was maybe the longest place I had been at, but it also feels like a blur. It was like being at a friend's house for 4 years straight and never quite feeling like you fit in. I think they were excited to have me at first, a bit like a new pet, but eventually they realised that a foster kid who didn't know how to communicate was a little bit more effort than taking them out for walks. So I left in September in a bit of a rush. The next place was a student accommodation for the Silverfish here in Leeds. And although I am a big fan of Leeds, I am also kind of excited to leave because I feel like I only came here because I was running away. And I want to go back. I want to find place number 13, I think, and see if next time I move, I'll be doing it because I want to be somewhere new, not because I don't want to be somewhere old. Currently, I am looking and I'm excited because even if it's just a box room, it will be properly mine. There won't be weird parents or stress or maintenance workers letting themselves into my bedroom. So this is a blank page. I didn't finish the poem, so I'm making it up off the top of my head. So yes, Leeds is, it's been a welcome recluse. And I'm very thankful for all that I've learned and getting to perform like this. And soon I will bid you all adieu. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Ethan. I've had a few poems published in Switzerland before, but I never said them out loud to anybody. And a lot of them sort of just got lost to time when I left. So this was a recent attempt that I made at recreating one of my old poems in sort of a new way. So hopefully it sounds good when it's said out loud. Across the way used to lie beauty, something made before me, before gods, before man learned to paint or stop rolling in his own shit. More color, more than color, this picture was life in the grander sense. Dead in reality, but still there, still breathing, moving, growing, shrinking, but now, maybe, dying. Between me and where this old beauty lay is now a chasm of gray, of ruin, built to imitate only itself, proving definitively and undisputably that nature, the old world, what was here before, has and will forever have an eye keener than any man that might deign to call himself an artist. It's a short one, so that's it. Thank you.
stepped in to do this set really last minute, and it worked really well. Thank you for everybody who read things in the open mic. Thanks to Poppy for organising the Poetry Festival again. She's an absolute powerhouse. And if you haven't already been to stuff that's happened at the Left Bank, then come to, and there's still tickets tomorrow for the anthology launch, which is about Leeds, and it's beautiful, and it's from 6 o'clock tomorrow. Have a good rest of your night. Feel free to stay while Ishi provides us the nice spooky tunes. Take care.
Reloading it.